Welcome to Adventures with a Very Small Lathe. A couple of weeks ago, I posted some images of a package I just had delivered of an impulse purchase. Today, I can reveal what I bought. A Lorch Model A straight-turning lathe. The lathe was shipped with all the major parts removed from the bed and even included this very large and very old motor. The first part I unpacked is the headstock, fitted with a three-jaw chuck, which is pretty big for a lathe of this size. The headstock drops straight onto the left end of the bed, kept aligned by the prism at the front of the way. The lathe includes an ordinary cross slide with a standard Lorch clamp for holding cutting tools. And a standard handwheel operated tailstock. The final bundle contains the clamps and hand screws used to fix all three of these parts down onto the bed and held in position. The clamp plates sit on the flat underside of the bed and allow a nut to hold each part firmly down onto the bed. Unlike an engine lathe where the carriage can move freely during turning operations, the cross slide on this lathe is fixed in place. This does mean the lathe is limited in terms of the operations it can do, but it gains in rigidity and simplicity. This stud for the cross slide doesn't seem to tighten as easily as it should, so I'll hand you over to my past self as I go over the lathe and assess its condition. It looks like the problem is the screw threads here are jammed up with gunge. The last plate is thinner than the other two, and this may not be the right place to it. I'll have to try and work out why one is smaller than the other two. This looks like really old compactive dirt mixed with oil and grease with some chips in there. So the standard dirt you'd expect to find on the underside of a lathe. The inside looks similar, but a little bit more greasy. That's still running a bit hard. See whether there's some lubricating water displacer and a bit of compressed air will fix it. I'll give that a few seconds to soften up. Still a bit tight, which may be a sign that there's been some thread damage. Maybe these threads are not quite as similar as they look. So this whole mechanism was shown on the listing to be working, including some videos of it moving, but it's clearly not seen much oil for a while. All the contact surfaces look pretty dry, apart from a couple of traces. So before I even try and move it to make sure I don't do any more damage or wear, I'm going to oil every single sliding surface I can find. This is Way Oil Mobile Vectra 1, the same stuff I use on all my lathes. This top slide has the sliding surface on the top of the dovetail, which is slightly unusual, but it also has a lower sliding surface on the back, but not on the front. Lead screw is obviously very important to oil. Very difficult to get to. The cross slide looks more conventional in that it has two lower sliding surfaces on the bottom of the dovetail, but the top surfaces also look like they're in contact, which I've never seen before, but I'm going to oil them anyway. Don't think any oil is going to get in that way. I'm also going to put a dab of oil on all the screws and fasteners, just because getting that soaking in will make it more likely I'm going to find them easier to undo later if they've gummed up with age. The same goes for the headstock. I'm being very cautious about turning it, oiling all the parts where there's a moving surface and a stationary surface in the same spot. And all the points on the chuck where oil can get in. This is not the way I would normally oil a chuck. This is about mitigating against damage from the fact this has been out of use for a while, making sure I can get some oil in anywhere there's sliding surfaces. This is way more oil than a chuck would usually need. And these screws on the back don't look like they've moved for a while. It looks like this is a back plate that is screwed into the back of the chuck itself. So there'll be a point there where it's going to come apart. So I'll put some oil on there just to ease the processes of it coming apart when the time comes. And of course, these screws in the back, which I'll need when I want to strip the chuck down for cleaning. I'm going to put some oil into the grease nipples. I don't plan to run this with grease. I plan to replace these with oilers. And lastly, the tailstock. Next obvious thing to oil is the bed, but to do that, I'll have to clear it. So I'm going to focus on getting these things sorted first, and then we can look at the tailstock later. I've given the oil a good while to soak in now, so I can now give it a try moving it and be certain that I'm not going to immediately damage it. So the lock seems to come undone pretty easily, and that's turning fairly smoothly, but it can definitely be better. Give that a wipe down to get rid of all the old lubricant, which is dried and contaminated. Looks in okay condition. Taper will require a bit more investigation. The surface rust on the exposed end is obviously old. There's relatively little pitting. I'm going to need something long to try and get in to clean out the bore. And I can't clean it out properly without undoing this whole mechanism. So I'll just do a quick clean for now. Yeah, I can't get in very far because the screw thread is right there. Give that the best oil I can, including plenty on the thread itself. This is obviously way more oil than it would normally take to lubricate the lathe. This is about helping to clean it, not about the amount of oil it needs when it's being used. And that's already running smoother. The cross slide has now had a chance to soak properly, and I'm going to give it a move. Bring it all the way back so I can get to the far side to add some oil there. This is the maximum I can get exposed at the full travel at this direction. Oh, just a few more turns. That's now really freeing up and getting a lot smoother. There's enough dirt in the mechanism that I'm definitely planning to fully disassemble and clean it before I use it for projects. But at this point, I'm just assessing what state the lathe is in. Top slide also appears to be moving okay, but let's get a bit more oil along the length. Again, I know this is massively more oil than it needs, but it's about making sure any old dirt and stuff gets dislodged and dissolved. This is about cleaning, not about lubricating. That's moving really, really nice and easy to the point where I think the gibs will need to be tighter. Which may be a sign that whoever used it last wasn't oiling it properly and they allowed it to get gummed up. But that's moving great. This is a little bit confusing. There is a shim there between the retaining block and the main casting of the cross slide. So this has clearly been wedged between these two parts, which very much look as though they would previously have been flush. And I can only assume that was done as part of a backlash remediation, which is one of the things I did in the Chinese lathe, where there was a little bit of backlash in there, and I actually put a shim inside to constrain the movement of the flange that's in there. What I suspect is that there is a flange on this shaft, a pocket for it to sit in, and that pocket should hold it between the casting and this block with a constrained movement, but with a small amount of movement, just because otherwise it would seize. What I can't work out is why that would need a shim there unless there was some kind of damage. There's no sign this is not an original part. Well, there's no time like the present. Let's take it apart and find out. Based on other lathes I've seen, there may be, in addition to these two screws, pins holding this block in place, but no guarantees. Bit tricky to get a grasp on it when it's against the plate. And it's honestly a bit unclear how this part has even gotten there. Wow, that is an incredible amount of really quite gritty dirt. Possibly that was an oil port, but it seems to be gummed up. I may not be able to get this apart without taking off the handle, which currently looks as though it's held in with a pin, so that's going to be something I have to do pretty carefully. In fact, there's no sign of the pin on the other side. See if I can get some of that dirt away. And it's labeled 25, which I thought first might be the pitch, but it's obviously a finer pitch than that. Okay, that comes out pretty easily. So there we can see the flange as expected, and the face of it I would expect to be flush, which it is. So I'm going to take this off. Don't see any sign that either side has any features on it, so I don't think it matters which way around it went. Use some displacer to try and soften up the harder dirt. That feels extremely flush, though there is a bit of scoring there, which may be caused by the shim. There's a very, very shallow pocket in the face there, which would make sure that even though this face is very flush to the block, there would still be a little bit of room to make sure it can move. Some oil on that. I've just realized the direction of the screw thread. This is a regular right-hand thread, which means this handle actually works in the opposite direction to the direction I expect from the more modern lathes I use. So just pushing this by hand the movement still feels free. Leaving a bit of slack in that screw until the other one is in place, so as not to accidentally constrain it in the wrong position. That is not going in easy. Nope, that doesn't want to go in. Maybe I'll switch them around. Sometimes two identical screws are not as identical as they look. Just check everything is aligned and moving before I tighten it. And that is moving exactly as I expected to. For now, it's a mystery why that shim was there. Possibly to buy another millimetre or so of travel, but I can't see any reason why you'd need a millimetre of travel that badly. That's now moving great, and it no longer looks unsightly. Still not entirely clear what this hole here is, as I couldn't get around the back of the block to see where it went. It's not even clear whether it goes that deep. There's no equivalent on the other side. Possibly some kind of pin. Oh. Okay. When I turn it, you can clearly see movement there. Ah, it looks very much like an oil port. So let's put some oil in it. That's now moving even more freely than it was before. When I come to seriously clean this lathe, I do want to try and take this whole assembly apart and get around the back of that flange to make sure I can get it completely clean. But looking at it right now, I don't think that's going to be easy to do without damaging the handle. That pin, what looks like a pin, looks like it's been there for a very long time and there's no obvious way to get it out. If you know how to get out pins like that, please let me know. This scale is split as if it should clearly slide to adjust the zero. Right now, it's not moving at all. Let's put some displacer and some oil on that, see if I can get it soaking into that grime and starting to soften it for when I get to the point where I try and get that moving again. There's no similar adjustable scale on this side. And here, the screw appears to be held in place either side of this, and there's a screw on the back here, so disassembling that may be easier. I missed oiling that screw earlier, so I'll do that now. And I've had a lot better luck on old machinery covered in grime like that with moving screws if I get some oil onto the outside of the screws a while before I try and undo them, as the oil seems to sort of soften up any old grime. I'm going to want to undo all of these screws eventually, so all of them I want to get the grime softened up. And it looks like we have another oil port. The downside to this kind of oil port is there's nothing protecting it against dirt around the lathe going into that oily area, unlike the button oilers that I have on my more modern lathe. It would be tempting to give this a blast of compressed air to try and get the dirt shifted, but I'm not doing that because you run a risk of the compressed air pushing dirt particles further into the mechanism and driving them into places which are even harder to get to. I'm trying to make sure whenever I use displacer, this definitely not actually WD-40. Whenever I use it, I make a point of removing as much of it as possible and then replacing it with proper slideway oil. The lighter parts of WD-40 evaporate off pretty quickly. The heavier parts of it are really designed to inhibit corrosion and are way too waxy to actually lubricate, which is why spraying something with WD-40 often causes it to run for a while and then seize up, as the lighter stuff evaporates off and the heavier waxy water protectors are left behind and don't really help lubricate all that much. There's a fair amount of gack on the screw there. See if I can get that off. That's run all the way to the end of its travel now, so I can oil along the entire length and even get some oil inside the nut. More and more in the oiler now that that port is empty. And this is consistently getting better all the time. Bit of resistance at that end, I'm not going to push it. The angle of the top slide or compound is clearly locked by this screw here, and that appears to be moving freely. This is definitely not an original screw. That's a modern cap screw. It's an imperial size. And if I had to guess, that looks a little bit like a Whitworth angle, which is something I've come across in old German lathes before. The lead screw itself looks metric and is a custom one, but the fasteners are standard Whitworth. It looks slightly ugly, being a clearly modern fastener on an old machine, so maybe I'll look at making a custom replacement that fits a bit better. To be suitable for this job, there really should be something with a much bigger head, so it can clamp against this flat surface without having to bear on a tiny narrow bit of washer to do so. And to look the part, it would need to be a slot head, as all the other screws on this lathe are. there's often a second lock available, and that is in fact the case here. Under the, on the underside of the compound, there is this locking lever here, which is currently doesn't actually have a lever. Just use any tool, and turning it away from the vertical position will lock this. Probably wouldn't be secure enough to lock it under machining forces, which is why the nut is there, but this is suitable for adjusting and indicating just to get it in the right position in the first place. The final bit to look at is the headstock. Actually rebuilding or disassembling the spindle is a very involved and difficult thing that I really need to be very careful not to screw up, so I'm not going to even touch that right now. Based on what Emma Ritson has done with her very similar lathe, I think I'm not going to end up using grease on these, but it does look as though grease has been used before. So let's take these off and see what's going on underneath. So there's plenty of sign of old grease in there, though I managed to get most of it out before I had the camera running, so you missed it. But yeah, you can see there it is. It's not in great condition. So I'm going to have to try and find a way to work out how to get that out, which is almost certainly going to require me to disassemble the whole spindle. The trick is going to be learning how to make sure when I do it back up again that I tension this correctly, which looks like it's a pair of locking nuts, which I don't have a tool for or a pair of tools for yet. And there's also this locking ring as well. As far as I'm aware, these will be a plain conical bearing. So a cone shaped that way or taper there and a cone there shaped that way. All the headstocks with this type of bearing I've seen typically have one major pair of screws at the back, which tension the whole thing together, which it's incredibly critical to get correct because overloading it will cause the bearing to seize or wear excessively, and underloading it will leave a lot of slop, which will allow it to move. This is not something I've seen on most lathes, but it has. I have seen it on some other Lorch lathes. So I'm going to have to learn how to deal with the adjustment of these two separate screwing systems, whether you preload it first and then this one locks into place afterwards, or it's not quite the same. It's not two locked together. It's a single ring with a locking screw in the middle of it. I'm not going to touch any of that now, but maybe I can see if I can get the chuck off. These are obviously custom-made screws, and they seem to have a 12mm head on. They're awkward to undo because there isn't much space to turn the head between there and this brass retaining ring. Or, I don't know if it's a retaining ring or maybe it's just a shield for the front of the bearing, probably the latter. Unfortunately, this ring, which I'm pretty sure should just be plain brass, appears to have been painted and painted against the front of the headstock, so it's now going to be stuck. Anyway, because there isn't enough space for me to fully undo these bolts at the same time, I'm going to have to inch them out one at a time. That is all three of them clear. So unusually, this back plate doesn't bear against the main outer part of the chuck, which I would normally expect to get the most stability. Instead, it fits entirely inside this diameter, and it bears against this secondary surface. In some chuck designs, this secondary surface isn't part of the main casting or main body of the chuck, but in this case, it looks as though it might be. At some point, that'll need to be disassembled to try and work it out. I've oiled all of these screws to make sure that I will be able to loosen them when the time comes, but for now, I'm not going to leave them alone. There is the usual amount of chips and grime you expect behind a chuck, which I can clean out. This back plate seems to be threaded onto the spindle. Let's see if I can get rid of some of that dirt around the thread there. The thread doesn't seem to want to move, which is made more difficult by the fact that there's almost nothing I can actually get a grip on that isn't round. Nope, that's not coming. Put some more oil on that to soak in and see what happens. This is going to be important to loosen up because the lathe will be of very limited use if all I can put on it is the single three-jaw chuck. I'll put this back on for now as I've removed as much grease as I can. Let's have a look at the other one. There's a fair amount of grease in there. I'm being careful not to press the point down into the plane bearing on the spindle itself. Just get up as much grease. That is not clean grease. While the spindle is moving okay, I don't want to run it under power until I've got the lubrication replaced, or at least topped up with something much better than grease. Putting oil in there at this point is probably a bad idea, as I'll just end up with a horrible emulsion mixture of oil and grease, which will just make a mess. The last thing to look at is this motor, which looks pretty interesting, but also looks as though it didn't really survive shipping in perfect nick. Based on the diagram or the photos with the listing, this is the clutch lever. The clutch being made of a cone shape here on the flywheel and the conical inside of the pulley here. The two come together and that forces the pulley to turn, whereas otherwise when they're apart, the flywheel can turn and the pulley can remain stationary. A spring here to keep them apart when they're not being pressed together. See the sliding friction surface of the clutch on the inside of the pulley there. And there's a yellow metal sleeve to make sure that the pulley can slide when it's not engaged. So this lever to engage the clutch was made of plywood. And while that was almost certainly strong enough for it to work under load, it looks as though the sheer weight of this motor at some point in shipping came down on that and caused it to shear off. I'd may be able to fix that by re-gluing it with epoxy just to get it to the point where it works again. That will at least allow me to work out how this works before I commit to making a more permanent replacement. Or it may just be good enough. I don't want to start trying to make a replacement without at least working out how this works. And it seems like the best way to do that is to do an ad hoc repair first, check it out, give it a go, and find out what I need to know in order to be able to replace it. A couple of folks on Instagram asked about the lever. This is the lever that I showed in the shop. This is used to press against the bottom of this lever and allow the clutch to be operated from in front of the lathe without having to reach over to engage or disengage the clutch. The motor comes with a mounting plate that can be used to adjust the belt tension, so that's great. Weirdly, the three pulleys here are in decreasing order from left to right, which is the same order as the left to right order on the headstock, which means that they're in the wrong orientation to be able to get three significantly differing ratios. So it looks as though something about this setup was put together by somebody who didn't really know what they were doing, or they had different requirements, which I don't really understand. In this arrangement, you either have the belt going from the big to big, medium to medium, or small to small, which won't give you significantly different speeds. So I don't see any reason why anybody would do that. So in addition to the lever being broken, this pivot here on the bearing doesn't appear to be pivoting very well. And I think it's necessary for that to pivot in order for this lever to work correctly. So it's possible that the shock it got during shipping has also caused that to seize. So I'm going to need to take apart that whole assembly and work out what's going on. So there's a bunch to do there before this motor is usable and running, which I'm okay with because there is a bunch for me to do with the headstock before I get it running as well. So that's the end of my assessment of this lathe. Overall, I'm very happy with what I've got for the price I paid for it, and it's going to be fun getting this thing working. In terms of whether this meets my ambitions for the lathe I want, it probably doesn't, but it's a really, really cool lathe to have, and it's going to be a really cool project to work on for a bit. Thanks for watching. Take care. I love you all.